to my lovely wife, Julie. My name is John Skipper. I'm the pastor of this wonderful, awesome church. Just look around at yourselves. Have you ever seen such a handsome, beautiful group of people in your life? Hey, look around. Say to the person on your left, you look marvelous. Say, aren't you glad you're sitting by me? I just got one more announcement. Mike Nelson, stand up. This is our men's coordinator. Hey, everybody. I couldn't think of a more macho, manly, and godly man to have as a men's coordinator than Mike Nelson. He's also a Bible scholar. He loves the Word of God, and we're going to have a Bible study for the men this Tuesday night at 7. A few good men. Awesome. It's going to be good. Great. And then now, we're going to show a quick video of our Blanketing the Streets ministry. Charlie put this together. Everybody look back there. Is Charlie doing the camera work? This is one of our compassion ministries. I believe the church should reach out and touch people, don't you? We need to be outward focused. So this is one of our ministries where we're outward focused.
I'd like to thank Pastor for allowing me to speak here on behalf of our ministry. We all bow our heads in prayer. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to talk about your ministry that you put upon us. Lord, we ask that you walk in front of us to show us the way, walk behind us to encourage us, walk above us to protect us, below us to carry us when we're unable to make it on our own, next to us to be our friend, and inside us so that we can feel your love and that others see your love through us. I ask that you bring your Holy Spirit down to anoint this presentation and the worship and the pastor today. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like to talk to you a little about Blanketing Our Streets ministry right quick. Okay. Hey, Pastor told me to keep it brief, so let's see here. Alright. And then he told me make sure to leave enough time for his sermon. So thank you for your time. Just kidding. Everybody did want to talk to you about our ministry. It was God put it on our hearts back in 2009. It was a particularly cold night, and we saw a lot of homeless people out on the street, so we decided to go get some blankets for them. And as I was passing out blankets that night, I was just about ready to leave when I saw a little flicker of light coming from behind some bushes by a church. And when I went to go investigate, I found a gentleman back there, and I called out to him. And when he answered me, I just asked if he would like a blanket. And he just had this blank look on his face, and he said, "I was just praying for a blanket like 15 seconds before you drove up." So obviously God was in charge of that. And once that happened, we just took it from there and expanded to where we are now today. We also get food to the needy. We help single mothers, single fathers, people in the church, anybody that might need some help. We also help the Children in Crisis Center, which is a foster home set up for neglected and abused children. Anything we get that's donated that's for kids, we make sure it gets to them. We also do a crop drop, which is where all the farmers in the local area, the tri-state area, they donate the crops at the end of the harvest, which is biblically based from the gleaning in the fields story that's in the Bible. And they bring it to Destin, and then we go pick it up in a truck. We bring it out here to the church, and This year, it's going to be on the 22nd of November. We will have a truck out in front here at the church, and you just take whatever you want. And then on the 23rd, which is a Monday, we'll put the truck out in the parking lot, and that'll just be for the community, for whoever drives up and needs food. Last year, we had sweet potatoes, we've had corn, we've had watermelons, a variety of different foods. We never know what we're going to get, but God always takes very good care of us in this way. This year, God has taken us in an additional area, additional direction, rather, by bringing the community and our church together by having a free dinner on Saturday, September 19th at 5 p.m. It's open to all, and there's a sign-up sheet in the hall, so we know how much food to make, and we hope that this brings the community and our church together. We have a short video here that I'm going to show you right now of some of the things that we do. So watch this, and I'll be right back.
There is a candle in every soul, some brightly burning, some dark and cold. There is a spirit who brings a fire, ignites a candle, and makes his own. So carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the hopeless, confused and torn, and hold out your candle for all to see, and take your candle and go light your world.
Love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. You have answered correctly, Jesus replied. Do this, and you will live. But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? In reply, Jesus said, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he fell into the hands of robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. When he went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine, then he put the man on his own donkey and took him to an inn and took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 silver coins and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have. Which of these 3 do you think was the neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? The expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. Jesus told him, go and do likewise. The 2 silver coins leads me to my next point. Let me ask you a question. If you were to lose a dime, would you miss it? Probably not. This is where you can help. If each person gave a dime each time they came to church, it would go a long way towards helping someone in need. It may not sound like much, but God has taught us how to stretch that dime into a meal for a hungry person. You can make a difference. Just take 2 nickels, rub them together, drop them in the jar, and let God do the rest. Thank you, and God bless everyone.
They've changed their focus. They've been going to Fort Walton, feeding the homeless there. Now they're going to come to Navarre and feed our homeless here. So for 7 years they've been in Fort Walton. Now they're going to come here. And let's pray. I'll tell you a little bit more about it. Lord, thank you for this time that we can give. Lord, to leading this wonderful ministry. We just pray that you bless our gifts. In Jesus' name, amen. So Donna came to me recently. Said, Pastor, that Fort Walton homeless are inundated with food. They have a lot of food over there. And so I said, hey, why don't you come to Navarre and feed our poor here? And then I realized that we already have a list of addresses and phone numbers and names of several hundred people here in Navarre who regularly visit our food closet. Do you know we feed a lot of homeless, or not homeless, we feed a lot of poor folks right here in Navarre. And I kind of classify these people as the working poor. They're working, they're just poor. I mean, now we're living in hard times. I mean, some of us are prospering, doing great. Others are at the other extreme, right? So Donna had a great idea. Let's go through this list of hundreds of names. Let's send them a beautiful invitation to a dinner. Let's bring them to our church and let the pastor preach to them. And so this Saturday, we're going to have a dinner here. We're going to host the 4 of our neighborhoods, and we're going to feed them. And I want it to be a great meal. And we're going to have a fantastic meal. And we're going to entertain these people, and I'm going to share the love of Jesus with them. And we're going to win them to the Lord. Amen? We're going to develop relationships with people. These might be, I guarantee you, they're some of my neighbors. Right? And so it's going to be fantastic. A friend of mine who has a big church in Chicago, he had his secretary and his wife go out and hire like 7 prostitutes. Brought them to the church, and they had this gourmet meal made for them. And he came in with his wife and his secretary, and sat down with these ladies and just listened to them and talked to them and shot the breeze, you know. And then he started to ask them their needs and how did you get to where you are and really caring about people. How many know people need to know how much you care? The old saying is true. They don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And he sat down and he was able to share the love of Jesus with these ladies. And every one of those prostitutes left their business and started serving the Lord in the church. Isn't that amazing? Because he took a step of faith, right? Let's do this crazy thing. Let's go hire these prostitutes. Can you imagine? Let's bring them to church and let's just share and then we can help them, right? That's what we're doing here this coming Saturday. So I'd love to have a bunch of us here with them. So sign up in the back. It's just awesome. I appreciate Charlie and Donna's heart. Don't you? Love it. Christians can get too heavenly minded to be any earthly good. I don't want to be that way. Last year I made sure I was down there in Fort Walton hanging out and feeding the poor, the homeless people every Monday night, and it was a blessing, I'll tell you. It was awesome. Changed my life. I want to stay in touch with people, don't you? A lot of pastors, a lot of people, we just get cloistered with our few friends. They're all, we get a lot of good Christian friends around us, and we don't really reach out to unsaved people. We don't even relate to unsaved people anymore. And I don't want to be that way. I want to be able to go to any place to be able to talk to the unsaved church people and relate to them and not be so strange. Christians can get a little strange, can't they? You know, I was thinking of strange. I've been doing a lot of thinking lately. I was thinking the other day about John Belushi. Do you remember him? Shake your head if you remember him. If you don't remember him, you're young. Because he died in 1982. Can you believe it? 82? He was 33 years old. And I'm thinking, you know, young guys, they get handed the world fame and fortune, and then they go off the deep end, they get in drugs, and just, they live the pleasure principle life. Whatever feels good, do it. You know, wasn't that the mantra of the 60s? If it feels good, do it. Right? If it's good for you, get all you can, it's even better for you. Is that true? No. The more pleasure and all this that you get, it becomes a curse. And it became a curse for him. He was addicted to alcohol, and then he died. Same thing happened to Jimi Hendrix and a lot of these young people. And I'm thinking, what a tragedy. How many great movies could John Belushi have produced? Or songs? Remember, he was the Blues Brothers. I love that, right? How many great movies, the music that he could have produced throughout his life? How many great songs or albums or CDs that Jimi Hendrix could have produced? But no, he burned both candles, burned the candle at both ends. And when you live for pleasure, when you live for self, right, you wind up losing everything. It's sad. That's such a paradox, isn't it? You think, oh, God wants me to be happy, so I'm going to indulge my flesh and be really happy. But Jesus said it's better to give than to receive. Didn't he say that? It's more important for us to give. Then, when we give ourselves and stop looking after our own needs and being the center of our world, we start looking at the needs of others and helping others, guess what we get in return? Joy, happiness, contentment, right? Peace. Can you lay your head down on the bed at night and say, I'm in good hands. God's got me. He's got my back. I'm safe. I'm going to heaven. I can relax. I did good today. I helped a few people and I made a difference. I mean, there's a great peace when you know that Jesus is your Savior. Incredible peace. You don't have to worry about so many things. Many Hollywood actors have died young. I don't know if you know Gene Harlow.
Yeah.
You're really old then, aren't you? I don't know who that was, actually. What about James Dean? James Dean? James Dean, yeah. He was cool. Apparently, I didn't see his movies. Heath Ledger? Heath Ledger, remember him? I loved his movie about the sword. He was a jouster. Night's Tale. Great movie. Great spiritual principle in that movie. You can change your stars. That was great. Okay. How about Hank Williams Jr.? Before my time. Senior.
Senior.
Right, junior still alive. Excuse me. I'm going to write the senior down there. Buddy Holly. Going way back. Otis Redding. Janis Joplin. Jimi Hendrix, Kurt Cobain, young people. Well, not that young, I guess. Amy Winehouse. I don't know who that is. I know what she looks like. But I didn't listen to her music. You know, all those people, they died before they were 30. Died before they were 30. Man, their principle of life was faulty, right? They're going after the pleasure, living for pleasure. And you get trapped and you become a slave of that pleasure, whether it's drugs or what have you. They missed the greatest joys. I mean, if you miss your 30s, I mean, if you just go to your 20s, 20s are turbulent years, right? You don't know what you're doing in your 20s. When you get in your 30s, you start realizing, hey, okay, 30s are great. If you miss your 30s, you're missing out on some of the greatest pleasures of life. And the simplest things are the greatest pleasures of life. Marriage, delivering a baby. You ever delivered a baby? You ever been in the room when a baby's delivered? That's a great experience, man. I think they should have some rock and roll music when you deliver a baby. One of the greatest joys of my life was cutting the cord on little Jonathan when he was born. I got to cut the cord, man. I couldn't get it to cut. It was like a hose, man. It's like, this is tough. I'll never forget that. And if I never lived into my 30s, you know? If I burned both candles, if I lived the fast life, I never would have had that joy. Then when Holly was born, C-section, a lot easier. At least for me it was. C-section, great. What great joy. And then holding the babies, late at night with the bottles. I mean, it seems like it's horrible, but it's not horrible. It's awesome. I look back, I think my kids now, Holly and Jonathan, Holly just started college. And Holly was playing the piano, or the keyboards, and Jonathan's upstairs in the children's church. And I'm thinking, man, both my kids are in college. I was like, man, I miss the days where I could hold them. I miss holding kids, I love babies, and wrestling with them, putting them on your shoulders. And I miss all that. And I'm thinking, that's my 30s, right? And then when I was 40, they were too big to carry around. But what great stuff that when you don't live fast, if you don't live for pleasure, when you live for other people, man, it's really living for other people when you become a father, is it? Or a wife, a mother, and you just put your family first. Man, that's a great deal. It's a beautiful thing when you see people who understand this principle of living and giving for other people. When you see people who have a hold of that, they are awesome people to be around. That's who I surround myself with. I don't surround myself with people who are always taking, 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 and just the center of the world. I hang around with people who are givers. Right? I want to be like them. I want to be a giver. And I hang around with one guy that I remember as a giver. Maybe he might have been to Destin and been deep sea fishing. There's a guy named Ben Marler, Captain Ben Marler. Anybody know Ben Marler? He was an old man. I remember years ago, I was in Tallahassee, I brought my youth group over to go deep sea fishing in Destin. So we go to this giant catamaran boat. It was the biggest catamaran you've ever seen in your life. And it was early, I thought it was really early. It was probably around 6, the sun was just coming up, and there's a crowd of tourists, okay, and me and my youth group, and we were there to go deep sea fishing. We just thought, man, we're going to catch marlin and just grouper. We just had these dreams of great fish. And there's Ben Marler, and he could barely talk over the years of talking so much, I guess, because he did it every day. He'd have a group of about 50 or 60 or 70 people there, and he'd tell them how to bait the hook. He had that big old weight. You got to hold on, make sure you hold on to the weight. If you let go of the weight, you get stuck in the finger with the hook, and you got to put the squid on there, you got to put it on there twice, and, you know, it's just, and he would start witnessing to people for Jesus. He'd say, man, it's like sin. If sin will get a hold of you, it's like this hook, and it's not going to come back out. You're going to be trapped to sin. And he would use his daily spiel in teaching tourists how to bait the hook and how to fish. He was fishing for men. And he was witnessing, and day after day, year after year, old Ben Marler was preaching the gospel to strangers. And I thought, that man's a giver. He's giving something to people more than fish. Right? He has given them Jesus. Everlasting life. he is giving to people. And I thought, man, that is so much more important than a day on the sea, isn't it? And I'm like, Ben is a giver. Proverbs 11:4 says this, one person gives freely, yet gains even more. One person gives freely. Okay, here's a spiritual principle we have to get in our heart. One person gives freely, yet gain. Everybody say, gain. How many want to gain? Nothing wrong with gaining, right? We all want to do better, right? Well, the secret is one person gives freely. There's your secret right there. You start giving freely, and you will gain even more. Another withholds unduly, but comes to poverty. One comes to poverty. If you withhold from people who need, you come across needy people all the time. Don't withhold from them. And if you're a withholder, you'll come to poverty. Verse 25 says, a generous person will prosper. A generous person will prosper. How many of you are prospering? Are you prospering? Are you a generous person? Probably. Right? The people I know who are prospering are also givers. Amen? A generous person will prosper, and whoever refreshes others will be refreshed. Amen. I like that. You can live by the Scrooge complex if you want. I'm going to live by the abundance mentality. So I serve a God who owns the cattle on a thousand hills. And that's putting it mildly. I don't even know how much cattle on a thousand hills cost, but in other words, the guy has everything I need and more. And so I'm going to live by that principle where I give and give and give. My God is going to take care of me. Amen? That's the abundance mentality. The people with the abundance mentality are not worried where their next dollar is going to come from. They're givers. I'm going to give. But this is the last 20 I have. That's all right. I'm going to give it. God's going to give it back to me. Bam! You turn around. There's two more in your pocket that comes to you. There's a thing called karma. Have you ever heard of karma? Buddhists and Hindus believe in karma. According to them, all beings accumulate karma based on their actions, and karma dictates their life circumstances. When a person dies, the karma accumulates in that lifetime, and all previous lives determines his or her lot in the next life. Buddha taught this, listen. He taught that desire is the root of suffering, and desire leads to suffering and causes other people to suffer. This produces negative karma. So if you eliminate desire in your life, you'll eliminate suffering. Can I tell you something? I don't believe in that. I think it's okay to have desires. In fact, the Bible says God will give you the desires of your heart. God puts those desires in your heart. I don't believe that if my desire is to hurt other people. Because my desires, now that I'm a Christian, my desires is to help other people, right? And so when my desires in my heart, man, I was praying, Lord, I want to win souls this Sunday. I want to win souls, you know? That's my desire. Is that going to hurt somebody? Nope. It's going to help somebody, amen? That's my desire. When you serve Jesus, he changes the desires of your heart. Proverbs 13:4 says, a sluggard's appetite is never filled, but the desires of the diligent are fully satisfied. So if you work hard, that's what that's saying. Your desires are fully satisfied. So Proverbs 11:31 says, if the righteous receive their due on earth, how much more the ungodly and the sinner? So the righteous people receive their due on earth, man. So God is going to reward you. God's going to reward you. You keep doing good for others, God takes notice. Amen? Turn in your Bibles to 2 Corinthians 9:6. Get out your Bibles. I want to camp here on this scripture verse. I tell you, if you start living these scripture verses, I'm telling you right now, your life is going to change for the better. Amen? God's word is true. His principles. We're talking about principles here this morning. His principles are timeless, and they'll change your life. 2 Corinthians 9:6. This is the law of sowing and reaping. Okay, there's a spiritual law, just as truthful as the law of gravity. Here's a spiritual law we Christians need to understand. The law of sowing and reaping. Remember this, verse 6. Whoever sows sparingly will reap sparingly. Okay? Sowing, right? A farmer sows seed. The word sows means you give to others. Whether it's money, whether it's time, whether it's, you know, a listening ear, whether you help them cut their grass, okay, that's sowing. You sow seeds in other people's lives. So whoever sows sparingly, that means very little, you'll also reap very little. Whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Look at verse 7. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver, right? So we'll never tell you to give if you don't want to give. God doesn't want you to give if you don't want to, right? If we give, we should say, hey, I've decided in my heart to give this money away, or I've decided in my heart I'm going to give this block of time to this family, or I've decided to give, okay? We are not going to make you give. God doesn't want to make you do anything. It's got to come from the heart of love. You've got to want to do it, not out of compulsion. If you just, each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to bless you abundantly. Are you reading that with me? That up there. God is able to make all grace abound to you. I like it. Don't you like that? Who is able to bless you? God is. Who's the all-seeing eye who knows everything that's going on? God is. Is it karma? You sow good, you get good. It's not karma. It's not an impersonal force. Can I tell you something? The one who's going to bless you is a personal force. His name is Jesus. The impersonal force who sees everything that goes on in this world notices when you give to other people. He notices. You don't tell anybody. You don't have to announce your giving. In fact, don't. Don't announce your giving. You go and you help people, you help the needy, right? And you give generously. Guess what? The one who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Amen? You know why? He wants that behavior to continue. Right? Like Pavlov's dogs, right? We hear the bell and we salivate. Well, God rewards you because he wants your behavior, which is giving, to continue. I'll tell you, the first time you give something away and then unexpectedly something good comes back to you, you're going to want to give some more. And then you're going to say, I should have given more. Right? I should have given more. God is able to bless you abundantly. That's the law of sowing and reaping. Here's the spiritual law of proportion. Verse 6, if you sow sparingly, you'll reap sparingly. So, what do? We give generously. There's a preacher one time, he had saved money. Like he said, he saved $15,000 in his savings account. That's a lot of money. Okay? How many think that's a lot of money? How many don't think that's a lot of money? Come see me afterwards. We'll talk. Okay, 15 grand. A lot of money, right? This preacher had been saving it for years, and it was for his daughter's college. How many know that college is important, especially for your daughter, right? And so he saved $15,000, and then he heard of a ministry that was needing finances, and he heard, he felt a voice inside of him say, give the $15,000 that you're so proud of. Give it to that ministry. He's like, get thee behind me, Satan. That's not God. That's not God. I don't receive that. And he ignored this voice for a long time. How many know the devil's not going to tell you to give money away, right? Probably the Lord, okay? I would always check with my wife first before I started giving away 15 grand. And so he finally did it. He gave 15 grand. That was his savings. He gave it all to this ministry. And a few weeks later, he got an invitation to preach at a very large church. He goes and preaches at this very large church. And you know, when you preach at a church, they give you an honorarium. His honorarium check, the pastor brought it out to him, gave it to him. He opened the envelope. Looked at it, it was $75,000. I'm going back to that church, right? And he heard a voice again. Oh no. It was the voice of the Lord. God said, sow that back into this church, into their missions department. He's like, his hands started shaking. Okay, here, pastor, take it back. Put this in your missions department. Man, I gave away $15,000. The Lord blessed me with $75,000. I should have kept it, you know? And when you hear the voice of the Lord, you need to obey, okay? I'm telling you. You think you're giving up a lot, but the Lord has a lot more in store for you. Because lo and behold, one night he's sleeping, and he has this dream of a little invention, right? And he's like, when he woke up in the morning, he was so jazzed about this little product that he was going to bring to market. And so he did. He brought it to market and he sold it and made millions of dollars. Is that amazing? Do you believe that God can give you an idea, right, that can produce millions of dollars? Because he was obedient with 15,000, that seemed like a lot then until the 75,000 came. And that seemed like a lot until the millions came. You see why it's important to be obedient to the Lord, even if you think that's a lot of money. God owns the cattle on a thousand hills, amen? You reap what you sow, amen? Years ago, I had a car. I had this great car, Oldsmobile Cutlass. 1986. Great car, man. My grandmother gave it to me. You remember that car, Cindy? Wide, and it drove. It was real fast. I loved it. V6. It was fast. We used it. And then one day we bought a brand new 2004 F-150. Four doors. Two-wheel drive only. That was a big mistake. But anyways. At the time, I was not a hunter, but now since I've become. But anyway, so we traded in. So we had this extra car, and I said, Julie, who do we know who needs a car? And we said, there's a boy in the youth group. His mother cleans hotel rooms. He lives in a trailer with five other kids, and his grandmother and his mother, she works so hard, he has no father. Let's give it to Travis. So we gave it to Travis, and what a blessing it was to Travis. He was able to go to work, and I'm telling you, this kid was good seed. And here's the secret to giving money away. Make sure you put your seed in good soil. Yeah. Someone's drinking, smoking, living off their money, don't give it to them. You know what I'm saying? Put it in good soil. Travis, we knew him for years. He was at church every Sunday, every Wednesday night. He'd bring his homework in the church van. He was always doing his homework. He was on the basketball team. He went on to college, Troy State University. He was point guard for 4 years at Troy State University. And this kid was a hard worker. And I said, Travis is good soil. I'm going to sow a seed into Travis's life. And it blessed him, blessed his family with all the kids. He could take his brother to practice football and baseball, and it blessed the family. And I'm thinking, you know what? That's awesome. I love to bless people. And you know what happened to me? Just recently, God gave us two cars, one for my son and one for my daughter. I'm like, wow, talk about sowing. Reaping what you've sown. I sowed a car. Years later, I reaped two cars. I'm like, that's so incredible. I'm telling you. Last December, when it was my birthday, we looked on Facebook, and Travis, who's now got a good job in Tallahassee, he's a grown man now. Travis put on there, I want to wish a happy birthday to the only father I ever knew.
Aww.
Oh, man. I did some good. The only father he ever knew was me.
Wow.
I'm like, man, if we're going to touch people, we've got to touch people. You want to make a difference in somebody else's life, you've got to share your life with them. Share your home with them. A friend of mine had an SUV, kind of old, not too old. God told him to give it to a poorer family in the church, a family in need. And he said, Lord, in his mind he said, that car is not that old. It's still got a lot of meat on the bones. That's what he said. And so he didn't want to do it. You know, men, we're a little stubborn when God speaks to us. We like to hang on to stuff. And God kept nagging him. You know, God doesn't speak audibly to you oftentimes. Oftentimes it's just a sense. You sense his voice giving. Because the devil's not going to tell you to give to other people. Okay. So he finally gave in to God. And this is the godly man, I'm telling you. So he gave his car to his family. And over the summer, God started blessing his business so much that he had so much money left over at the end of the summer. God said, now you can go get the car you've always wanted. He felt a release in his spirit to go buy that Porsche. True story. So here, check this out. I didn't know Porsche does this, but if you will fly to Munich,
Stuttgart,
Germany, you can buy a Porsche from the factory. You can drive around as long as you want in Europe. He took his whole family over there. They drove around Europe seeing the sights and all this stuff. He told me later, he said, he grew up in Kansas. He said, you know, I never would have been able to drive around Europe if I didn't take a lot of missions trips. and I felt comfortable driving overseas. But since he was a man of God, took a lot of missions trips, he was comfortable, took his family. They drove that four-door Cayenne, Cheyenne, big old monster.
Panamera,
whatever. And he's driving around Europe, bring it back to Stuttgart, they change the oil, clean it up for you, bubble wrap it, and send it to America. That's the blessings of God. I'm telling you, it pays to listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit. Amen? You will reap more than you sow. It's not just about money. Turn to Romans chapter 12, verse 6. God wants us sowing all kinds of stuff. I love this. Romans 12, 6. God's word is so awesome. Can you read His word? His word will change. If we start living the Bible, we will change our communities. Look at this. We have different gifts. Is that a fact or what? Everybody has different gifts. We have gifts, different gifts and talents, according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. I like that. I like to put a little emphasis. If your gift is serving, then do it. Serve. If it is teaching, then what?
Teach.
Then by all means, put your gifts to work. Amen? If it is encouraging, then give encouragement. How many would raise your hand if I have the gift of encouragement? Do you like encouraging people? That is one of my favorite gifts. I love to encourage people. And I really work on that. Then encourage. If it is giving, then give generously. Right? Love it. How many have the gift of giving? If it is to lead, this is a great gift, leadership. If your gift is to lead, then do it diligently. See, these are all different things God wants us to do. It's all still the same principle, right? Sowing and reaping, right? If you're a leader, you're leading in God's house or in the world, do it diligently, faithfully, and you'll get back. Everything will come back to you and bless your life. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. I love mercy. Show mercy and do it cheerfully, right? Don't be a grumpy, merciful person.
You're forgiven. But don't do it again. I'll forgive you this time.
Why do you need to be a cheerful, merciful person? The point in all this is God expects you to do something. Amen. God expects you to sow. He expects you to sow even in your time of need. You remember the widow? There's Jesus and the disciples. Remember the story? Jesus and the disciples hanging out in the back of the church. In Catholic churches, they have a box in the back where you put your offerings. We like to send an intimidating usher in your face. No. So, Jewish custom was there was a box in the back, and you give in the box. And Jesus was hanging out with the disciples, read the story, and he's watching people give. And there was a widow who gave two little mites, two little pennies. And Jesus said, she gave more than all the big givers gave, because she gave out of her lack. She gave, she couldn't afford to give. That might have been all she had. Maybe she was saving that for a Coke. She would say that for something later on, maybe a piece of bread. But that was all she had that she gave. So that was, to her, proportionally more than the rich folks, right? Because if you have $1 million and you give $1,000 away, that doesn't hurt a bit, right? She gave out of her lack. Turn to 1 Kings chapter 17. I'm going to close with this. Here's a very important story on giving that we really got to understand. And I'm not going to take another offering today. All right, I've already taken two. I don't want to take an offering when we're helping the poor. That's a good thing. This is the story of Elijah and the widow of Zarephath. Okay? So, verse 7. 1 Kings 17, 7. Says, some time later, the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. Then the word of the Lord came to him, Elijah. Go at once to Zarephath in the region of Sidon and stay there. I have directed a widow there to supply you with food. Okay. This lady's dirt poor, right? So he went to Zarephath. When he came to the town gate, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called to her and asked her, "Would you bring me a little water in a jar so I may have a drink?" As she was going to get it, he called and, "Hey, bring me some bread." Verse 12, "As surely as the Lord your God lives," she replied, "I don't have any bread, only a handful of flour in a jar and a little olive oil in a jug. I am gathering a few sticks to take home and make a meal for myself and my son that we may eat it and die." The lady was at her last. She just had enough. She's going to have one last meal. It was a terrible famine in the land. Her last meal with her son, eating die. Elijah said to her, check this out. Let me tell you what he didn't say to her. "Don't worry about it. I didn't know you were that poor. Don't worry about it. I'll get my own." He didn't say that. Listen to what he asked. Elijah said to her, "Don't be afraid. Go home and do as you have said. But first, make a small loaf of bread for me from what you have and bring it to me. And then, make something for yourself and your son. For this is what the Lord says, the God of Israel says, the jar of flour will not be used up, and the jug of oil will not run dry until the day of the Lord, the day the Lord sends rain on the land." She went away and did as Elijah told her. So there was food every day for Elijah and for the woman and her family. For the jar of flour was not used up, and the jug of oil did not run dry, in keeping with the word of the Lord spoken by Elijah. Is that awesome? Wow. That's an incredible story. And we better learn from it. Point number one, write this down. God even calls the poor to give. Okay? Being poor is no excuse for not giving. You see a lot of people down on their luck, a lot of people who are single mothers, and a lot of people who are, you know, in a bind. They dry up and they stop giving to others. Can I tell you something? You're withholding God's blessing upon your life by circling the wagon, hoarding. Don't do that. The poorer you are, you should be giving. If you don't have money to give, man, give time. You know, go serve. Be an usher, a greeter, whatever. Work in our food closet. Whatever. You need to serve. God calls even the poor to give. It's called sacrificial giving. It means more to God, right? Point number two, give what you have, not what you don't have. I heard a story the other day of my old uncle. I'm not going to mention his name, you might know him. He went to a church where the pastor and the church, they got into multi-millions of dollars worth of debt to the tune of $40 million. So the pastor leaves the church and a new guy comes in, he's saddled with $40 million of debt. What do you think he's preaching on? I don't know how much a month he had to pay to the bank for $40 million, but it was astronomical. Could have been like $100,000 a month. What do you think he preached on all the time? Giving, 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 giving. You guys gotta give. Aren't you glad I don't want to browbeat you for giving? Give. And so my uncle, man, he felt so guilty, you know. He mortgaged his house to give that money to the church. Don't do that. Don't mortgage anything. Don't go in debt to give to the Lord. We serve a big God. Amen. Give what you have, not what you don't have. Amen? Point number four, expect a great ROI. Don't shout me down. A lot of you are going, is that some new internet word? Return on investment. Expect a great return on your investment. Jesus said, he who lends to the poor lends to the Lord. Do you think Jesus is going to borrow from us and be a debtor to any man? No, he does. He's not going to be. We lend to the poor. Jesus says, okay, now I got to give it back to you. Right? They're my children. Like if someone takes my family, if they take one of my kids out and they go out to eat and they pay for my kid, what am I going to do? I'm going to pay the family back for paying for my kid. Right? I don't want to be a debtor to any man. So the Lord's not going to be a debtor to you. So the more you give, guess what? He's going to give it right back to you. Isn't that awesome? God is good. Don't get stuck in reap mode. Reaping, reaping, reaping. I'm a poor person. I'm this. I need everybody to bless me. And bless me. And get out of that mode. You're in that mode, right? Get out of it and start blessing others. The heavens are not going to open above you until you start giving to other people. There's needs all over this world. There's poor people. Africa's full of poor people. And God is not meeting their needs. God is waiting for people to take a step of faith. Either pray, go to church, give whatever you have, whether it's your time helping around the church, it's not always money, but you've got to give something to the Lord's work or to other people before you get God's attention. Doesn't that make sense? Our church board, I remember Greg, it was probably 7 years ago. I had a friend who was a pastor of a dinky little church in Pensacola. And he said, man, we got this, he was complaining. We got this lame soundboard. It's like from 1970, right? He was complaining about his soundboard. And so I feel for the guy. I've been there, right? And so I came back and we had a board meeting. I said to Greg and the other guys, I said, hey, there's a friend of mine. He's a little church over there. He's got this junky soundboard. Maybe we could bless his church. You know what they said? We don't have that kind of money to help. No, they didn't say that. They said, hey, that's a great idea. Let's sow seed in another man's field, right? And so they said, Pastor, let's do it. And I forget the amount we decided on. It was like something like $600. You know what kind of soundboard you can get for $600? Nice one. Like, I got a 24-channel monster stuck it in my back seat. I took it over to his church. In fact, we didn't even meet at his church. We met at Brownsville Assembly of God parking lot. And I'm there. And I said, hey, I just want them. You know, I didn't mean to bother you. I didn't tell them what I had for them. And I said, hey, my board and I got together. We just want to bless your church. Right? We're not going to get anything out of it. We're helping somebody. We love him. We do it out of love, right? So we gave him the soundboard. His eyes went, that's for me? I said, yeah. So then he told me later, he took it back to his church, and one of the board members was a sound man, and when he saw that board, he just started crying. He just couldn't believe it, that someone way over in Navarre would see their need and bless their church. It just blew that church away. It blew their board away. But didn't it send a great message? Probably a lot of good messages, like, we care about you, you're a brother. This is a gift of encouragement. Keep up the good work. You know, they shall know we are Christians by our love one for another. Love is not love until it's given away, right? That's action. And so we just, and then you know what God did to our church? We turned around, we bought a digital soundboard that's like second to none. Fantastic, right? Then we got a new, I mean, God has just been blessing this church. I'm like, that is the key to success, my friend. You start giving unexpected gifts, and it blows people away, and it's the funnest thing to do, right, is give people. One day, the men's group, we decided to go help a church in Gulf Breeze, and they had these bushes that had grown into the woods, and it was the longest stretch of bushes you have ever seen in your life. It was a hot July day. Did anybody, was anybody on that? Anybody? Mike, you were there? It was a men's group. We went, this was a long time ago. We went to Gulf Breeze, and we cut and trimmed bushes. We were so hot and sweaty, and then all the clippings were on the ground. Then you gotta get all the clippings. Well, when you're going to help them, you, and then we'll take care of the clippings. I think we just went out on military property and dumped them out. Is that legal? But hey, what kind of message did that send to that other church? Amen? And God has been blessing our church. Here's another one. 2 weeks ago, was it 2 weeks ago we took the offering for Convoy of Hope? Right? We took up an offering here to go to poor people, to feed people, right? And we took up our biggest offering ever. It was $10,000. I was like, yes, you guys are awesome! So we gave a $10,000 gift. It goes to Convoy of Hope, which helps feed people all over the world. And after natural disasters, and they're just a great organization. So every year we take an offering. Do you know what happened for that whole month? Okay, that's like, okay, $10,000 goes in and out of our, you know what happened to the finances of August? Best month we've ever had in 10 years that I've been here. Our finances came out of this church. That makes a pastor happy. But isn't that like God teaching our church, if you guys will give, I will blow your socks off. And then the first week of this month was our biggest week we've ever had in 10 years financially. I'm telling you, the more we give, the more it comes back to us. You reap what you sow. You sow cars in other people's lives, you reap cars. You sow food, you're going to reap food. You sow kindness, you're going to have a lot of friends. If you go help people, like build stuff and help, you know, cut grass or whatever, guess what? People are going to help you. I think it's sad. A lot of people say, well, God never does give me anything. You ever hear people just pour mouthing? They're complaining. Well, God's done this, and God hasn't done this for me, and God hasn't done that for me. And I'm just thinking, wow, you got such a bad attitude. I'm surprised he gives you anything. God loves a cheerful giver. He loves a cheerful person. Attitude is everything with God. If you will look beyond your disabilities, if you'll look up beyond your poorness, your whatever, if you look beyond that and you start giving to other people, God will take notice of you. You're not doing anything to get God's attention. Yeah, you complain. Yeah, you have a need. Yeah, but doesn't everybody? Right? Yeah. Well, you need to learn this principle of sowing and reaping. You need to start stepping out and blessing other people. You'll get God's attention. I love Acts chapter 10 of Cornelius. Cornelius was an Italian Roman soldier. Okay? He's not a real friend of the Jews, was he? He's an Italian Roman soldier, but he loved God. And he prayed and he gave alms to the poor. Okay? And it says in chapter 10 that Cornelius' alms that he gave and his prayers went up before God into heaven as a memorial for him. In other words, there is this big statue of Cornelius in heaven, and God and all the angels saying, wow, Cornelius is giving. Let's go bless him. All right? If you want heaven to take notice of you, you start praying and you start giving. Your giving and your prayer will go up before God as a memorial for you, and he and all of heaven will take notice of you. He will dispatch angels to your help. To help you, he'll dispatch whatever to give and bless you because, hey, you're a selfless giver. Isn't that awesome? I'm going to close with this story. Remember Johnny Appleseed? How many of you remember the story of Johnny Appleseed? Guy that's named, he was a real person, okay? During the westward expansion, middle 1800s, Johnny Chapman was his name. And he loved nature, right? He was just a happy Christian, okay? He loved nature, he loved apples. He had planted seeds in the ground and start vineyards, apple farms for people as a way for them to make money.
Orchards,
thank you. And he was going around blessing people with agriculture, right? But you know what? He was more than that. And that's all we hear in our secular school books. Hey, Johnny Appleseed, run around sowing seeds. He's sowing seeds, all right. But you know what kind of seeds he was sowing besides apple seeds? The Word of God. The guy was like Ben Marler with the boat. Johnny Appleseed, Johnny Chapman, he's going around as a missionary, and he's spreading the gospel. He said, hey guys, I came to your town, I've got a great way for you to make money and feed yourselves, and it's apples. Man, I got all these seeds. Oh, Johnny, come in, let's plant an orchard and do apples. And he says, yeah, you know what else? Yeah, these apples, you know, you'll eat them, and they'll satisfy you for a minute, but I got some food that'll satisfy you forever. And it's Jesus. And he'll tell people about Jesus. And he used the apples to get into a community to share the love of Jesus. Feeding people is important, but giving them spiritual food is a lot more important. Getting people to heaven is a lot more important than feeding their stomachs temporarily, isn't it? Yeah. Let's bow our heads and pray. Lord, we love you today. We thank you, Father. Lord, you've called us as Christians to sow seeds in people's lives. Lord, because you were the ultimate giver, God, you gave your one and only begotten Son to us. Died on the cross. Lord, you didn't give an angel to us or one of the lesser angels, but Lord, you gave your very best to us. Let me ask you, if you're here today and you've never asked Jesus into your heart, you've never asked Jesus to forgive you of your sins, Would you raise your hand and say, pray for me, Pastor? Nobody's looking around. I just want to pray for you. How many raise their hand and say, pray for me, Pastor? I'd like to give my heart to the Lord this morning. Anybody would like to make a decision to follow Jesus? Anybody else? How many said to me, Pastor, I believe in God, I believe in Jesus, but you know, I've kind of gotten away from the faith, got busy with work and school and family. How many say, Pastor, I've kind of backslid a little bit. I'd like to come back to Jesus. I'd like to rededicate my life to the Lord. How many raise your hand and say, Pastor, pray for me? Yes, I see it. See that hand. Anybody else? Yes, see the hand in the back. Amen. Yeah, put the hands up again one more time. I want to see you because I want to pray for you. Put your hand up one more time. I want to pray for you. Yes, I see it. Hallelujah. How many would say, Pastor, I need prayer because I've got some needs in my life. I can't work them out. I don't know how it's going to work out. And I just need a miracle in my life. Maybe it's a financial miracle. Maybe it's a family miracle. Maybe your spouse and you are just at each other's throats. How many raise your hand and say, pray for me, Pastor? Yes, 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 all over. Yes. Can I tell you something today? God knows your need. He's already working behind the scenes. He loves you. Let's just pray. Let's go to the throne room of God. Let's pray. Just pray this prayer after me. Dear Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Write my name in the Lamb's Book of Life. I thank you for all that you've done for me. Thank you for dying on the cross for me. Lord, I lay my life at your feet. Lord, I'm not going to live for the pleasure principle, but I'm going to live for others. First of all, you, Jesus. I'm going to live for you. I love you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. God is good. Let's give the Lord a hand.